Okay, I'm going to introduce our next speaker, Nitamo Montecucco, who, as I say, manages the Biography globally. Nitamo is an expert in neuroscience, and he's written many books on psychosomatics. If you don't know what psychosomatics means, all will be revealed in a few moments.
All of you coming here from many different places, and I beg your pardon for my poor English, and I will try to do my best. Let's start from the new paradigm. The words of Erwin are really inspiring. We are living in an incredible historical moment, and not just for the new paradigm in general, but even specifically for well-being and health. We have all the main texts and books from all different traditions. Ayurvedic, Chinese, South, North American, African, European, Greek. And we can have the most incredible amount of experience and information and knowledge from all the past school, mystery school, health school, holy tradition. And in this moment, the incredible, in the last 20 years, scientists have started to study consciousness. Before that time, science was completely separated from spirituality or religion. Let's call it better to say religion as old stuff and let's say square vision and dogmatic rules. But we can definitely see that there is an inner spirituality that was the pregnant part of the great master of the past from all traditions. And this spirituality has been used to study consciousness by neuroscientists and doctors and psychologists. So in the last 20 years we did an enormous amount of information that are sustaining the whole past tradition. Let's make it like more clear. In the past we have body and soul. And there were doctors who were healing the body, as Erwin said before, as a mechanical part, as a chemical approach, as a surgical approach. And on the other side, there was all the healing, like a little bit new age healing, spiritual healing, hocus pocus, like saying, no, I will cure everything and mesmerize everything and energies. And we know now scientifically that just by using a kind of, let's say, magic strategy, you reach up to the 20% better health. This is scientifically demonstrated. So just the person that is giving you something, even something that is just nothing, just pure water, not homeopathic, just really pure water, and say this is really a great healing practice, he is getting better, your health is getting better, up to 10, 15, 20%. So this was the past healing experience. But even in the past, there were scientists, doctors, psychologists, healers, who were not just dealing with some kind of fate, some kind of thing I say that is working, but about something that remained. This is acupuncture, this is Tibetan medicine, this is all herbal knowledge from the past, this is all body approach, this is all energy approach, breathing, yoga, tai chi, qigong, kung yin, all practice from all kind of old tradition. And this remains, this is really something that have been demonstrated effective by science. science in the last 10, 15 years demonstrated that yoga is effective on a very large series, diseases. So is Tai Chi, so is breathing. Some of the practice didn't find any effectiveness, so have been abandoned. And still there are people that doesn't want to abandon their own faith. But soon in the next 10, 15, 20, 30 years, more and more people will start to follow a scientific approach to spirituality, to holistic health, to a psychosomatic human approach. And this must be there. So we can shift from a middle age of faith, of strange imagination or belief in system, to something that is absolutely real. And this is happening even in physics, in quantum physics, in biology, in genetics, in many fields. Now I would like just to show you shortly some pictures, something really in psychosomatic. Let's start from neuroscience. In the last 20 years, let's say even 30 years, many scientists, we study mainly Nobel Prizes research. So nobody can say that it is some strange idea of some strange scientist. Consciousness in science was legitimate by Francis Crick, who discovered the DNA. Consciousness is a legitimate field in scientific research. And to understand the complex nature of consciousness, we are quite necessary to be studied with a multidisciplinary and interdisciplinary brain approach. Let's see John Eccles. He first studied the evolution of brain and the creation of the self. He believed that consciousness is a growing process, it's not something coming from gods or other belief system. And the neuroscientist Paul MacLean started to study the triune brain evolution, seeing that the brain from fish, reptile, birds, mammalian to human being are just made out of three different parts. One is leading the reptilian brain, is organizing all energy, metabolic power force that is like the engine of the living being. The second brain, the mammalian brain, is organizing the information for relationship, for emotional stuff, from communication between animal or human being. And the third part of the brain is just the most, let's say, informational part of the brain, who is analyzing and organizing information, knowledge, and using the knowledge to understand living worlds and how we can live in this world in the better way, in a sustainable way, and even evolving, creating something new. In the last, this is the curve of evolution in time. So we see the very recent time, the brain, the new cortex of human being have developed in an incredible way, giving us the capacity for language, for history, for science, for arts, for an incredible understanding of our inner and outer world. This is a consciousness, the whole consciousness of a human being, and this consciousness is, let's say, in evolution is derived from a reptilian consciousness, a body consciousness, a mammalian emotional consciousness, and a mental consciousness. So we are our body sensation, our feeling, our memories, our relation, our ideas, our concept, our belief system. We are one. There is just one consciousness, physical consciousness, emotional consciousness, mental, intellectual consciousness. And this oneness have an incredible complexity, but still is just one. The people who are not feeling just to be one, schizophrenia, they feel to be apart, to be schizophrenic. This is a disease. There is the breaking of the self, the breaking of the oneness, of the unity, and it is a disease. And we can restore this disease. Nobel Prize Edelman was really a genius. He first said that consciousness is not a brain, a production of a brain area, but is a network, is a system that is created by a dynamic network of consciousness, a neural network between thalamus and neocortex. Let's see, the thalamus in the middle of the brain. The thalamus is synchronizing 50 times a second, 50 hertz a second, the whole brain neocortical information. So we hear, we smell, we see, we feel, and everything becomes one consciousness, one information for our being. I would like just to you, in this moment, to feel who you are. This is the beginning of meditation. Of self-awareness. Just feeling your body breathing. And your body breathing is an incredible... Yeah, let's do another step. Jack Panksepp, this incredible neuroscientist, was here 5 years ago. He discovered that there is not just the thalamus and neocortical network, but the thalamus and periaqueductal brain. Network is essential for life. Our consciousness starts from reptilian brain. Even every reptile has a consciousness. If you try to catch a snake or a frog, you know, they are escaping quickly in a very intelligent way. They feel and they have a self-consciousness. They are not aware of themselves being conscious. They are just consciousness of themselves, not self-consciousness. This is happening on a very higher level of complexity, and we see that. So, Jack Panksepp said, we are sharing the primary consciousness that is basically present in every animal. This is our physical body, and it's incredible intelligence. Just imagine we are eating and this our body is moving every atoms or every molecules of our body, of our eat, and becomes our body. And transform air and water and chemical in something very complex and articulate. And this is just an incredible intelligence that we can feel to be part of this intelligence in this reptilian brain, the body consciousness. There is all the wisdom of billions of years of evolution, of strategies to survive, of intelligence of adaptation. But we just say we are our mind. The normal people say you are not doing that. But normal people, old paradigm say, well, I'm me, I'm the eye of the mind, and my body, I'm using my body as a car. I'm just doing every work and every even sports, commanding with the brain, my body, not feeling really my body. It's like a mental dictatorship, a way to manage from the top down everything. It's like a pyramidal structure. This has been studied by scientists. We will see it in N1. So, when the whole three brains and three centers of consciousness are getting really together, we feel one. Otherwise, we are in our mind, or sometimes we stop our mind, we are just in our fear, like a panic attack. No mind, I can't control anything, and everything is moving my body, and I cannot manage. So, or sometimes we fall in love, and just there is a love, I love somebody, and I lose my mind, and I lose my body sometimes too. So it's like this way to appear under, sometimes is the mind on top, sometimes is the emotional brain on top, sometimes is the physical brain. And this is a loss of oneness, of unity. Pancet discovered that we have 7 emotional systems, and we share the same emotion with every basic consciousness of all living beings. These are the 7, some of these emotional part of the brain. We have in the brain the same, in the same place, from reptilian to mammal, to human being, the same place leads let's say, rage, dominance, activity, or lust, sex, or fear, anxiety, or basic body pleasure. These are already there in the reptilian animal. Then the mammalian developed few more area of emotional, the care, the oxytocin system in the brain, that is essential, because reptilians are just putting eggs in the sand or in soil, and the newborn are just going by themselves. They know everything, but mammalia cannot do that. Birds or human beings have to grow up in a family, and this is oxytocin, and it's so important that in the brain there is even the great panic system. When there is a lack of care, and the children or the little dog or cat is feeling alone, not with the mother, he starts to cry, and we just hear meow, meow, or beep, beep. And we just feel the same sound, around 50 hertz, and is creating inside us a sense of activating the care system. So we take the animal or the children or whatever. And we play, we have the play system, the dopamine seeking passion play dream like system. You will never see a reptilian, reptile playing, or having a kind of affectiveness. They don't have the system, so they don't have this behavior. So, by studying this system, we develop an incredible new system of healing, of human transformation. Let's go quickly. The reptilian brain with the center, the body self. The mammalian brain with the emotional self, and the neocortical mental consciousness. When all are together, this is a network, then we feel conscious. But when we feel self-aware, that means that we are becoming inside us and feeling that we are conscious. This self-consciousness is a like a feedback system, a recursive feedback system, that is creating an enormous quantum of information, more than before. And it's like lightning. Information are basically driven by electromagnetic waves. So when we increase the coherence of the EEG, electromagnetic, in the brain or in the body, we increase actually light. Electromagnetic are just photons. So when we higher the coherence of the system, then we have more light. And Sigma say that there is a group in Germany, that is even in Italy, that is studying biophotons, and they demonstrate that when a person is really healthy, the biophotons, the light, the intrinsic light of the wrong system is really higher than a sick person. And this is the map, the psychosomatic map. that we derive from our scientific research. Scientific research say that this system and hormones and neurotransmitters are enhancing the parasympathetic passive system, the relaxation system. All these dopamine, testosterone, oxytocin, adrenaline are enhancing the sympathetic charge, the activity, the tension in the body. You can find everything on the internet. When we are together, when we feel to be one, we are here. The self is whole. I feel to be my body, my heart, my mind, and I'm one. But if something happening inside and somebody doesn't give us enough care when we are young, the mother is depressed or too tense or there is not enough affectiveness, then we close our heart and we get into the grief panic system. Or if we have a very dominant parent, then we get into fear system. And since our childhood and in our life, we get all this conditioning. There are people who play too much, and people that doesn't play at all. That people have always in a very aggressive mood, and some people that even doesn't talk enough to be listened because they are full of fear. So we have all the energetic system that have been organized, like in China they call it the Shen, the spirit of the organs that are the emotional. So the imbalance of the Shen, of the energy of the organ, are creating basically all imbalance in the body. But this is a very old tradition. They grasp something of the reality. This is the reality we have already demonstrated is true. So we can, we went with Erwin 3 years ago in China and we showed this map so they can even shift from a very old believing system because they don't feel it anymore, like real. They believe is a dead system. And then many of them can change into a more scientific system without losing the meaning of the Shen. Sorry, when you are blocked in the normal or in the self or in the body self or in the emotional or mental self, then this system gets out of balance and you become too much dominating, violent, or too much manipulator, angry, seductive, arrogant, or controlling, rational, judging, or left the intuitive hemisphere get you too much dreamer, credulous, confused, idealistic, or too much dependent, introvert, depressed, or submissive, insecure, resigned. If this is going more, then we have the clinical psychiatric syndrome. It's the same neurotransmitter hormones like dopamine. If dopamine is balanced, you are here. If dopamine is really too much in excess, then you become that voice, you do something and you are acting like in such a way. If it's too much more, you are in a maniacal mood, depressed, maniacal, no? Sometimes too much depressed, no dopamine at all, or too much dopamine, not depression, but too much maniacality, histrionic, narcissistic. So this is a scientific approach. This information are sustained by scientific research. The main thing we will see sooner is like to work on the body, on emotional level, on a psychological way, and to restore the sense of identity, of self-awareness. This is the main center of our work. this guy, George, helped work with cancer, and they discovered that in the middle of the brain, they call it cortical and subcortical midline structure that are creating like a pathways between the main center of consciousness. But this is exactly the same as the old tradition. So we are now demonstrating that old traditions were absolutely right. The main changes, the Tantien, Gumai, Renmai, Muladhara, Sushumna, all name are the same. And so this approach is exactly the same in Indian tradition, chakra yoga tradition, in the same three places they call it Tantien, lower, middle, and superior Tantien in China, or this is the Tibetan map. And we study with Professor Sergio Serrano of the University of Milan, that he worked with the World Health Organization since many years. And we developed this neuro-energetic map. We get together the Chinese, Tibetan, and Indian tradition, channels and chakra. And we see that is exactly the same thing with a neurotransmitter and a neuro center in the brain and in the nervous system. The new paradigm in psychology, those guys, Kabat-Zinn, Siegel, Tisdale, discover how the old Vipassana tradition, Tibetan tradition, that was full of middle age fantasy concept, faiths, believing system. They took away every believing system and they just keep the basic technique practice of mindfulness. And mindfulness, after that choice, after that scientific sustain, becomes not. The first page of Time, but of many, many other magazines in the world. The science of meditation, the science of finding focus in yourself. These are the scientific research in the 2000, 2010, and now basically we are here. We are just here on top. So scientists believe, start to see and scientifically demonstrate that just by being conscious of yourself or of your breath, of your body, of your being, the whole brain changes. The whole neurotransmitter get together. The whole basic emotional system are getting into a balanced state. So this is just incredible. An action, a practice that is no cost, very easy to learn, to teach, to experience, can change completely our brain and health. So the reduction, the effect, the demonstration, scientific demonstration of mindfulness is reduction of stress, increase of feel-good hormones like endorphin, increasing hormone like oxytocin of affectivity, improvement of immune system, increasing of reducing depression, reduction of inflammation, improvement of heart and pressure, decreasing muscular and nervous tension. This is, no drugs can do something like that. So, these are done by neuroscientists all over the world, but we did something very new. And we discovered that in order to create a breakthrough in psychosomatic, in healing, we should understand the blockage. The main blockage is present in every old medical spiritual tradition. India, China, Tibet, South America, North America. So let's see. Canon. Fight or flight response. Sayye in the stress or general adaptation syndrome. Anyway, this is the stress. this is the stress, stomach pain, heart attack, and we just discovered that stress is the basic ground of all possible diseases. The most important diseases in our body. But usually we understand stress as a fight or flight response. But it's not true. It's true for anyone. When you were young, when you were old, could you aggress or bite somebody? Or when you were young, you could escape from your house or from the school? No. So the fight or escaping is not possible for human beings. Just a few moments. So what happened? We have to go and to learn from Henri Nagoni the inhibition of action. The mouse that couldn't not escape from electrocuted metal cage just get in a inhibition of action, a freezing state. They know everything. They cannot escape. There is pain and no escaping, no fighting, and blocking. And so amygdala, hypothalamus, adrenal, reactive reaction, that is the normal reaction in all animals, but in man it's not so. There is an inhibition of active reaction. So from mind to adrenal glands, and all the adrenal glands are increasing the level of adrenaline and fighting or escaping, but even just to escape from a dog that wants to bite you, you have to use a lot of adrenaline, noradrenaline and energy. Or you stop everything and you go into inhibition of action, fear, blockage. This is what Reich and Lowen discovered. They call it blockage, they call it in many other ways. But now we know the scientific background of that. So we see that most of our stress is due to the inhibition of action. Or somebody is inhibiting you in any way, by beating, by judging, by doing something wrong, by saying something bad, and you get blocked. And you block the tension in the muscle, you block the diaphragm, you block your heart, your breath, your throat, because you cannot express easily yourself in a true way. You have to say, well, I cannot do that, no? Is my professor is a big man, I cannot stand, I mean, tension, inhibition and tension, or inhibition and weakness. And it's like, I cannot do it, I can do anything, I can survive, I'm a loser. And this is basically stress, and this is basically called depression. When you don't have any more hope, and the whole neuroimmunitary system is going down. Or sometimes, in the very worst situation, you get into a dissociation. You get, you know, out of yourself. Cortisol. When you are in inhibition of action, you release an enormous quantity of cortisol. Cortisol means stress, immune deficiency, tumors, immunitary diseases, inflammation, hypertension, heart disease, diabetes, metabolic system, gastritis, osteoarthritis. This is just one molecule that is the basic molecule of fear, of inhibition of action. So, a new healing system needs to start from all practice, from yoga, breathing, well-being, eating in a good way, relaxing, dancing, everything that is opening your energy in a good way. But needs, let's see one more thing. This is the reptilian brain. Reptilian brain is activating grief, is activating happiness, is activating rage, is activating fear. The neocortex is inhibiting grief, joy, inhibiting rage or fear. So the basic structure that we have to balance is this neuropsychic dominance. It's a collective disorder. That means that or the mind is dominating heart and body, or sometimes, as we were saying before, the body is getting dominant and is doing what he wants. It's like, for maybe months, you are saying, okay, I have to eat less because I have to reduce my weight and so. And then one night you open the fridge and then you eat everything, 5 kilograms in one night. And this is the revenge of the body and our intelligence. It's like a dictatorial situation. Your body, shut up, don't eat, be quiet, and then the body reacts, a revolution. So we have to balance this state. And let's see, usually, in a psychosomatic integrity, we have this axis is very open and is very working. When we are in a self-awareness, it's like before and after, it's like we increase our inner light. When we close our heart, when we go to inhibition of action, it's like the heart is closing. We have seen in the last 20 years something like 30,000 people, and 95% of those people have closed their heart because of sadness, because of childhood, because of trauma, because of many, many different problems. And when you close your heart, you close the talus, that is the synchronization, is the synchronizer of the whole brain network. And then, instead of having this big pathway, you have strange pathway, like you increase in amygdala, surrenal, locus coeruleus pathway, that are not direct. So you think before doing anything. You think, what should I do? What should I behave? What, even in sex, that is the most, let's say, easy and instinctive action. You say, well, what should I do? Too much, too less, this is not proper. And every moment in the day, we are this mind that is controlling. This is the inhibition of action, is closing the heart, closing the lungs and the throat, blocking very strongly the diaphragm, blocking the stomach. We always have pain in our stomach. Try to do exactly like this. With the strong hand, just go inside, a little up, and just see. Usually we don't feel any pain, but when we push our stomach, then we say, well, there is a pain inside. This is sometimes the evidence of this condition. We block all the juncture. So this psychosomatic block that have been that we can find in almost 90% of population is mental hyperactivity, difficulty of expression, emotional and heart closure, diaphragm tension, insensitivity of the body. It's like inhibition of our instinctive reaction. When we see young people, we see people that are really spontaneous, natural. We are almost so much spontaneous, we are always awkward. So we open the heart. We found many, many strategies from right to wrong, to core energetic, to vipassana, mindfulness. Every possible school we are using for opening our heart, feeling inside who we are. And then we work together the two major pathways of psychosomatic healing, the rebalancing pathway that tends to balance energy, emotion and thought that are usually or in excess or in defect. But we have to imagine that we have work for the disinhibition affection, to release and free up the behavioral, emotional and mental conditioning, the psychosomatic blockage that hinder and prevent the normal functioning of the psychosomatic self. Those inhibition blockage can be just improved by energetic healing, cannot be changed. To change and to decondition and all the conditioning, you have to be willing to do that, and you have to do it. You have to change your mind, your behavior, your emotional reaction. So it's a work. We are doing 1 year, 2 years, sometimes 3 years working, once a month, so people can learn how to decondition themselves. So we use yoga, tai chi, energetics, breathing, everything, but we work definitely on this inhibition affection. So body work, mind work, this is the old dichotomic paradigm, or you work with self-awareness, body, emotional or mental self-awareness. And the work is really incredible. Just two pictures of the work we do. These are basic active meditation. And the results, because we monitor all our training, our protocol, psychosomatic mindfulness protocol, is just giving us an incredible effectiveness, clinical efficacy. And from deep depression, even light depression, normal state, to self-conscious being. This is measured through EEG coherence. And we use the basic tools of our protocol in education, and we reach more than 20,000 people all through Italy. We teach them, we train more than 1,400 doctors, psychologists and teachers, and we hope to do a good work.